Via and Harper Audio present Mother's Instinct, a novel of suspense by Barbara Abel. Translated from the French by Susan Pickford. Performed by Jeremy Carlisle Parker. A thousand thanks to Jean-Paul, whose help from the other side of the world was invaluable to me. Prologue. Laetitia parallel parked perfectly on the first try. Unfortunately, this did little to improve her mood.
The Nintendo goes off now, Milo. We're here,
she said automatically. The boy in the back seat barely raised his eyes from the screen. Laetitia climbed out of the car with her briefcase, Milo's backpack, and two bags of groceries. Her hands full, she knocked on his window with her elbow to catch his attention.
Come on, Milo, I've got all this stuff to carry.
Wait, let me just save the game.
The bags were sawing at her fingers, and her son's laziness caused Laetitia's temper, already simmering, to boil over.
Let's go, she snapped.
Her parking job was about the only thing that had gone right today.
Get out of the car now, or no Nintendo for the rest of the week.
Yeah, okay.
He sighed, still glued to the game. He slid over to the edge of the seat, set one foot on the sidewalk, and dragged himself out of the car like a dead weight.
And shut the door, if it's not too much to ask. Laetitia.
She froze when she heard the unexpected voice.
Do you have a moment?
She turned around. Behind her stood Tifen, panting in her running gear. A sheen of sweat covered her face, her bangs plastered to her forehead. When she got no response from Laetitia, Tifen went over to Milo and ruffled his hair.
You doing okay, big guy?
She said kindly.
Hi, Auntie Fen, he beamed.
Laetitia strode over angrily, grabbed her son's arm, and pulled him behind her.
Don't you dare talk to him, she hissed.
Tifen barely flinched.
Laetitia, please, can we at least talk?
Get inside, Milo,
Laetitia ordered.
But Mom,
now.
Her tone told him not to push his luck. After a moment's hesitation, Milo went inside, pouting. Laetitia turned back to Tifen.
Now you listen to me, you crazy bitch.
If I see you anywhere near my son again, I'll scratch your eyes out.
Listen, Laetitia, can't you understand that I never wanted—
Shut your mouth,
Laetitia hissed, eyes screwed tight in an exasperated scowl.
Keep your pathetic excuses to yourself. I don't believe you in the slightest.
Really? What do you believe then?
Laetitia gave her a look of utter scorn.
I know exactly what the hell you're trying to do, Tifen. But I warn you, if anything, anything happens to my son, I'll call the cops on you.
Tifen seemed truly taken aback. She stared questioningly at Laetitia, trying to figure out what she meant. Then, as if suddenly realizing nothing would change Laetitia's mind, she sighed, not trying to hide how Laetitia's attitude pained her.
I don't know what crazy thoughts have got into your head, Laetitia, but I promise you one thing. You're wrong.
Please, just try to believe me.
Not for my sake, but for Milo's. Because you're destroying him, bit by bit.
Laetitia arched one eyebrow, a look of contempt on her face. A cruel gleam flashed in her eyes like a lightning bolt in a stormy sky.
Well, I guess you do know all about destroying children, she shot back.
her voice almost silky. Laetitia didn't see the slap coming. As the word children left her lips, Tifenn struck her across the cheek. Laetitia stood stunned for a moment, eyes wide with shock. The groceries and bags sawing at her fingers seemed to weigh several tons. She dropped them to raise one hand to her cheek.
How dare you!
Tifenn raged, choking back tears as if to justify the slap. The two women stared at each other for a moment, sizing each other up, the air crackling with hatred. A voice rang out, interrupting the fight before it started.
Laetitia!
A man rushed out of the house Milo had just gone into. David grabbed Laetitia by the shoulders and pushed her behind him protectively.
She hit me,
she blurted, still in shock.
But some words hurt worse,
Tifenn stammered, aghast at the turn the confrontation had taken. David gave her a withering stare, weighing his words carefully as he pointed at her with a threatening finger.
You've gone too far this time, Tifenn. We'll be reporting this.
Tifenn gritted her teeth, barely concealing the storm of emotions raging inside her. It took her a few seconds to master herself. Choking back her sobs, she nodded.
Fine, David. You do that. You see, the big difference between us now is that I have nothing left to lose.
David gathered up the groceries spilled across the sidewalk and pulled Laetitia inside, slamming the door behind them. Tifenn stayed put, trembling all over, until she felt calm enough to walk back down the same path to her side of the duplex. She pulled the keys from her pocket, opened her own front door, and stepped inside. Chapter 1. 7 years earlier.
Cheers!
The three of them clinked their glasses, two champagne flutes and one glass of water, in a celebratory toast. There were sudden giggles, knowing looks, nods, and loving smiles. David and Sylvain sipped their champagne, savoring the prickling of the tiny bubbles. Laetitia put down her glass of water and stroked her boldly swelling belly.
Not a drop of alcohol since you found out, then?
Asked Sylvain.
Not a single drop,
Laetitia said proudly.
My wife is a saint,
David lovingly teased her.
You can't imagine what she's putting herself through to give our son the best start in life. Zero alcohol, zero salt, zero fat, low sugar, steamed vegetables, fruit all day long, fish instead of red meat, yoga, swimming, classical music, early nights.
He sighed.
The past 6 months have been so boring.
I'm not a saint. I'm pregnant, dummy.
Laetitia playfully smacked her husband on the thigh.
And she keeps going on about parenting rules. Poor kid. This mom will run a tight ship, let me tell you. You guys are already talking about parenting rules?
Sylvain looked surprised.
Of course,
Laetitia said, suddenly serious.
Best time to do it is right now. When you're facing the problem, it's already too late.
What sort of things are you discussing, then?
All sorts. Back each other up, don't undermine each other when the kid is listening, no sweets before they turn three, no coke before they're six, no Nintendo before they're 10.
Sylvain whistled, impressed.
We'll tell him that if you guys are too strict, he can always come over to us.
David glanced at his watch.
We should have waited for Tifenn before raising a toast, he said. She'll be annoyed she missed it.
Not a problem.
First off, she hates champagne, and anyway, she didn't want to stress herself out and keep us waiting. She's kind of tired these days.
Well, what's the champagne for, then? Leticia asked. A nice bottle of wine would have been fine, you know.
The question caught Sylvain unprepared. Casting around for a plausible reason, he sputtered,
Well, because, you know. I don't know, Leticia said, laughing at his obvious discomfort.
But then she realized there was only one reason to open a bottle of champagne. Good news. She studied Sylvain for a moment, sure he was hiding a secret, eager to tease it out of him. Then the light bulb went off.
She's pregnant,
she cried, bolting up straight in her armchair.
Huh?
Stammered Sylvain, looking even more ill at ease.
Are you two expecting to?
David asked, beaming in delight.
No,
exclaimed Sylvain.
Well, I mean...
The doorbell rang, saving him from their inevitable questions. Leticia leaped to her feet and waddled to the hallway as fast as she could.
Congratulations,
she called out, vanishing down the corridor.
Please don't say anything, Sylvain begged. She made me swear I would wait.
He turned to David, a look of comical dismay on his face.
She is going to kill me.
David burst out laughing and got up to kiss his friend on both cheeks.
Welcome to the club. How far along is she? 3 months.
Leticia opened the front door, her whole face lit up with happiness.
Darling,
she cried, her voice filled with laughter.
Our children will grow up together. Isn't it wonderful?
Without waiting for Tiffany's response, she pulled her in for a long hug. Chapter 2. Later, when they looked back on that evening, the first thing David recalled was the perfection of each moment. The incredible joy in each glance, each gesture, each word. Their future plans, their promises and laughter, and the feeling of coming home to a family, one he had chosen for himself rather than being dumped into, gave him the sense of connection he had so longed for as a child cut off from his roots. An unwanted orphan, passed from foster families to children's homes, he had climbed a steep, rocky path to adulthood, walking the delicate tightrope between good and evil, nearly falling off 100 times and clinging on 100 times more, until he fell off for good. Prison. And then a chance for a do-over. Back to square one. His own square one was right here. Leticia, and the tiny frog-like creature in her belly. His very own little munchkin. The son he would give everything he had missed out on, whose hand he would hold to keep him on the best path. He always said best path, not right path. Because as far as he could see, the right path didn't exist. It was a trap, a mirage, a lie told to children to keep them on the straight and narrow. Keep your head down. Don't draw attention to yourself. Just keep walking, head down. Don't glance sideways. What a joke. Real life isn't about straight lines. Life is one vast expanse of rugged terrain, riddled with obstacles, twists and turns, and deviations. A maze full of pitfalls with no straight lines in sight. The shortest path between two points is the one you know best. But whatever you do, whatever milestones you pass on the way, at the end of the road, you'll always end up in the same place. That's what David thought. Before he met Leticia, he had done what everybody does. He took the only path open to him, a rope bridge across a chasm, without a map or a handrail. Without the two guides who should have been there to shepherd him patiently and lovingly into adulthood. So he fell. He started out with petty crime. Pot at 13, coke at 15, barely into puberty and already chasing cash. Small-time dealing, the wrong crowd. He was caught up in the machine. Petty crime turned into burglary, breaking and entering, aggravated assault. 2 years in juvie.
Once he was out. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.